Studying the latest here, it has been very, very important to work with all of them in different aspects. And as a first slide, a disclaimer, when we talk about multi-messenger, of course, we refer to, we refer to the event together with electromagnetic counterpart. We talk about merger of supermassive black hole. This is the topic of my talk. But of course, when we talk about multi-messenger, we should talk also about the flaring blazar coincident with the ice cube neutrino emission. There will be the talk, then we talk about this, there will be Paolo and many others. So for the following part of the talk, when I talk about multi-messenger, I will talk about the gravitational waves electromagnetic counterpart. So let's start this journey going from merger of galaxies down to merger of supermassive black hole. We know actually from observation that observation of a dual and multiple AGN confirms that mergers are the precursor of massive black hole mergers and coalescence. Everything starts with the merger of hot galaxies at scale of hundreds of kiloparsecs of megaparsec separation. Then we will move, mainly due to dynamical friction, to closer separation among the nuclei. And in this stage, we will see the two nuclei shine as a dual AGN. So both supermassive black hole are shining as AGN. They are a separation among 100 of kiloparsec. Then we will start the phase in which the black hole, mainly due to three-body interaction, so the binary system together with the star of the galaxies, will start to lose, again, angular momentum. And this phase, when the supermassive black hole are gravitational bounded, we will call them binary AGN. In this phase, down to the coalescence, we will observe, together with electromagnetic counterpart, also gravitational wave emission. Here we are talking of distance about subparsec separation. So it's clear that it will be fundamental in order to understand the process going to megaparsec separation down to sub-microparsec separation. The point is that the merger of host galaxies and the merger of a supermassive black hole are separated by something like 100 of million of years up to gigahertz. While the latest stage of merging of a supermassive black hole are much faster than this time interval. And we don't know actually how matter and gas behave in this latest stage of the merging. It is particular in this stage that it will be fundamental to observe together electromagnetic counterparts as emission of a precursor of gravitational waves emitters. So in this case, it should be fundamental to observe both messenger because we would like to know the whole process going to megaparsec down to the coalescence of the supermassive black hole. I will show you the dynamic of the coalescence. The observational properties are quite, difficult to understand. I hope to convince you that this is the case. So let's start with the questions, actually. Why and what we learn observing AGN with both gravitational wave and electromagnetic counterpart. What we learn about AGN when we observe the same event of coalescence, but then we should go even more than this, because hopefully at the end of the next decade we will have a plethora of massive black hole that have been observed with gravitational waves and electromagnetic counterpart. What we could learn observing this plethora of AGN with both these messenger. So due to the fact that this is the first section of the morning, let's also focus on the answer to this question because it will be nice to do this. And I just focused on three main properties. Of course, the list is not exhaustive here. However, I will focus on these properties of massive black hole binaries as observed with the gravitational waves, electromagnetic counterpart, and both messengers together. In the part of the properties, of course, the gravitational waves I showed you before could tell us about the property of the separation, the black hole mass ratio, will tell us much more about dynamical of the gas in the moment of coalescence. Sorry, dynamical of the black hole at the moment of the coalescence. The electromagnetic counterpart could provide us with good candidates to be observed before the coalescence, but I will show you that any of these candidates are very conclusive about what we expect to observe. Of course, both of them will allow to measure black hole parameters. It's also physical parameter linked to the gas as the Eddington accretion, the mass accretion rate. The massive black hole evolution, if we observe a gravitational background detection rate, this will tell us about the detection rate of merging massive black hole we expect to observe. The detection of dual AGN and binary AGN will tell us about the whole evolution of the system, as I showed before, from megaparsec to sub-parsec scale. And of course, with both of them, we will provide a census of the evolution of mergers down to the coalescence of massive black holes. Finally, as we listened yesterday, we talk very often in our study about massive black hole and galaxies coevolution. In this case, of course, it's easy to understand that we will be able to observe and to measure black hole mass spin with gravitational waves. We will measure all the host properties of galaxies with electromagnetic counterparts. Then we will be able, with both messengers, to calibrate the relation we are using nowadays for our study. So I hope I've convinced you that it is very important to make this kind of study. And I would like to stress that this, while these refer to an investigation of a massive black hole population, this one refers to the possibility to detect the single event of coalescence. So let's start our journey going through galaxy merger down to the coalescence of black hole. I'm an observer, so I would like to show you how difficult and tricky is the journey going from what we think is happening and what that is actually it's happened. Okay, this is the hard galaxy mergers. I don't want to show, this image is very nice. However, we have mergers of dual AGN, a scale of a kiloparsec, down to kiloparsec separation. And we talk about dual AGN for these cases here. While when the system are gravitational bounded, that we have separation of below the kiloparsec, we talk about binary supermassive black holes. What we see, I would like to invite you to a journey going to the larger separation down to the closer separation of subparsec. So this is a journey going to the larger separation. At the closer separation kiloparsec scale, we have this detection of the narrow core from a radio interferometry with two systems separated of something like 7 parsec. Then going to larger and larger separation, of course, we could use other diagnostic. The point is that here, for example, we could use large server in infrared or optical or optical images, but we'll show you that it's quite complex in identifying AGN with clear diagnostic when we talk about infrared. While for the optical, we are somehow biased against absorption. I will show you in a moment. Of course, X-ray will offer the best chance to detect shining AGN with high Earth X-ray luminosity larger than 10 to the 41, 10 to the 42. Of course, here, the spatial resolution is much worse than the previous one. So we will detect the larger scale separation system. Up to now, the best separation we could effort, the best energy spatial resolution, the one offered by Chandra, will have something like 2 kiloparsec at 0.1 in redshift, 8 kiloparsec at zeta equal 1. Here I put two easy cases, very nice actually, in which we have separation of few kiloparsec of the system. This will be mainly serendipitous discovered by Chandra. However, life is not always that easy, because here, another very clear, the famous example of NZC 6240. However, if you want to go at the limit of the PSF on the instrument, you should rely in appropriate and delicate simulation of the PSF of the telescope, and you could able to detect something even with longer exposure. It's not so easy, I would like to say. To make things even harder than this, we know that these systems are heavily absorbed. Here you see a plot of merging galaxies in the first two panels in the early stage of merging, something like kiloparsec, 100 of kiloparsec separation, the early stage of merger. While below you will see late merger phase in which the system belongs some tidal interaction. And if you measure the fraction of absorption in these two different stages, early merger, late merger, it's clear that it is an increasing importance of the absorption. This is even more, clear if you compare what's happening in dual system at different scale of separation with respect to some isolated AGN. It's clear that these systems are highly absorbed with respect to isolated system. But in fact, also comparing the morphology of the galaxies hosting the merger together with the column density, we see that in the case of disturbed or merging interacting galaxies, there is a clear correlation with the absorption. Then the first message is that this system hosted in multiple are heavily absorbed with respect to the isolate, the IgM. It is actually, you may understand, it's a problem when you observe them in soft X-ray or in optical. Let's moving at closer separation when the system is not resolved anymore, so we should relay somehow on spectroscopy. How you do something like this? We relay on the so-called double-peaked IgN. So the idea is that each IgN in this dual system is carrying out the narrow line region. So here you may see in the optical the O3H beta for three different systems. You see there is this double peaked, mainly due to the motion of the two systems hosted in this dual. There have been a systematic study or large survey. This is the best chance we have to take advantage of the large survey in the optical. And more than 1% of the IgN population hosts double peaked IgN. But even in this case, this is not the whole story, because when you look at this system with some high spatial resolution, you use the integral field spectroscopy in which you could resolve each part of the system. There are systems in which you see the double line that could be confirmed to be dual, because here you may see the high resolution imaging, the flux line of three, the velocity dispersion, but a lot of other systems just have this, double peak the IgN because of the motion of the narrow line region, something like this. So the kinematics of the outflow could detect this as a dual IgN, but they are not. And 98% of the optical double peak the IgN actually are not dual IgN. So life is hard, actually. Let's see what simulation tell us, because we are going to investigate from the observational point of view, and would like to have two proxy on how this system behaves. The first one is the rate of dual IgN with respect to single IgN. The second one is the fraction of absorption. So in numerical simulation, in numerical simulation, we have the benefit that we could reach high spatial and time resolution of this order of magnitude. However, it's not cosmological simulation, so we could not measure the dual IgN with respect to a population of single IgN. However, we could measure the time in which both IgN are shining with respect to the time in when just one IgN is shining. If you look at this simulation made by Pedro Capello, you will see that when the galaxies get closer, the dots inside are shining more. This means that the accretion is increasing, and that means that in this case we will observe most easily a dual IgN. If you measure the fraction of this dual IgN cycle with respect to different kind of simulation with different black hole mass rate, this is the fraction of dual IgN with respect to the different color are different kind of simulation. You could focus only in a couple of the same colors. Let's focus on the first one because in agreement with the observation. When we compare this fraction of a dual IgN with different studies that has been done in optical and X-rays, you see that there is a pretty good agreement with this simulation. So we are starting to understand how actually this merging works. The other proxy is the absorption. These are other numerical simulations in which we see the absorption that is expected as a function of the projected separation. An average value is around 10 to the 23 in this case. It actually, this is a very good agreement if you remind the slide I showed you before with the observation we made in the optical and X-rays. So let's move now to the binary supermassive black hole. So we are going even closer and closer. In this case, of course, life is even harder because these are the main observational techniques that are used with decreasing separation, going to parsec separation, down to sub-microparsec separation. These are the orbital period time scale. You may see we have different techniques we could use. It would be quite hard, I will show you. The point is that our system will spend in this stage something like hundreds of millions of years. So we should expect to observe this system at sub-parsec separation very often in our large survey, for example. So these are systems that we should learn how to detect because we know they should be there. So let's move to some technique that should be possible to use. The first one refers to Doppler shift emission line. Thanks. And here, very similar to the double peaked emission line we were observed, I talked earlier, the idea is to have a system in which you may have one single AGN shining, for example, this is even harder, I would say, with respect to a center of mass and with another supermassive black hole that could even be not active. What's happening? You would see a Doppler shift of the broad line region emission line with respect to some narrow line that are a bit not moving because they are produced much far away with respect to the BLR, and you will see it is moving of the broad line in the, through the blue side and the red side as the system will move along the orbit. So this could, you should expect to observe a time-dependent shift of the broad line observed in this system. So let's have a look to the data because we are plenty of data. And in fact, there will be several sources. These are several systems that have been observed in the optical with Sloan. This is the rest frame H beta emission line. This dotted line are the shift of 5,000 and 10,000 kilometers per second. You may see that for each system, you may see something of a few hundred kilometers per second. So yes, there's something that is moving, but this is an example of an AGN 4593 in which here there's the shift velocity with respect to a time scale, and you may see that there's a shift of the velocity of the broad emission line, but it is not due to any motion of the system, it's just due to some kinematic of the broad line region. Actually, this is due at an echo of the H beta with respect to the increasing luminosity of the system. So even in this case, we cannot trust in this single way to measure the fraction of subparsec dual AGN. Going to closer separation, now we have a milliparsec separation. So the best way, the most direct way we have to observe this binary is to observe a modulation on the photometry life curve. The most famous case is OJ287. Why is the famous case? This is a binary AGN. It's 100 million AGN orbiting 18 billion solar mass AGN with a time scale of 12 years with the nodal precession of the disk. Why we have been so good to measure this variability? Because the source has been observed for 100 years. So we were able to observe several phases of this orbital period. Other attempts to make this kind of study has been done with the Catilina real-time survey, the Palomar transient survey, with a plethora of hundreds of sources for which has been produced this light curve. This is the most clear, I would say, example of PG1302 with a period of something like 2,000 days, but here the coverage is only 20 years. So the point is that in order to follow different period, in order to follow several phases, we should select system with very short orbital period. However, this kind of variability has been observed also in X-ray. These are the hard X-ray backlight curves of two systems. And when you make an epoch folding, you are something like a power spectrum density of the system, you may see that you may recover the period of the system and confirm the binary origin. In this case, it will be interesting also to know that this period that has been measured with this variability is also in very good agreement with some other diagnostic that we use. However, even in this case, there is the other face of the medal because IGN are variable, of course, we know. And these are the same data points I showed you in a previous slide. And this is the fit that has been done to prove the binary nature. These other two panels are just using the same sampling of the data, a kind of simulation produced with red noise. You may see that in both cases you could recover the variability simply due to the stochastic variability of the source without invoking any dual AGN or binary AGN presence. Now we have a problem because if the periodicity is false, well, we should know how AGN behaves. We cannot do anything else on this. But even if the periodicity is true, we could not be sure that the given variability is due to the binary AGN because there is, I don't know, there is plenty of examples. For example, I'm thinking to the QPE of Erosita or something like this. So it's very hard to finalize this kind of observational idea. Now, at the final stage of the merger, so the two black holes are almost at sub-milliparsec separation, we are at the end of our journey, we actually don't know what's happened this time of the evolution. There are a lot of models, a richness of different states. We know actually that there should be a circumbinary disk, there should be a flowing gas filling this mini disk that should behave like a standard accretion disk in AGN, but we don't know. There's this gap in the middle. So, as I said, there is a richness of possibility to have a prevision of how these things will go. I cannot stay here today because actually the first reason because I don't know, but also because it's very complex. However, we could trust in three general statements about this stage. The first one is there is periodicity. These are simulations as expected in the hard and soft energy band, few hours before the coalescence. And you may see you are expecting variability. The second one is enhanced brightness because in these accretion disks, at this gap in which gas may flow, will emit much more by shock than a standard Sakura-Sunyaev viscosity disk. So brightness should be enhanced. And then we should expect to see very strange shape in UV X-ray because you may see that from UV to X-ray, we will have a composition of the circumbinary, the mini disk, the stream gas on the cavity. So we should expect to observe emission spectrum that is different of a single AGN. So let's move on. What could we do now in order to be prepared or when we will have some more, clear idea of gravitational wave from supermassive black hole? Of course, there are simulations made by Alberto Mangiagli showing the goodness of localization with LISA depending on the mass of the system, the mass ratio, and the redshift. As an order of magnitude, you may say that for a light black hole, 1 month before the coalescence, at zeta equal 1, it will be localized by 100 degrees square. It's a lot. The idea, of course, the best will be to follow the final stage with wide field of view instruments in order to try to make a picture of what's happening when the pre-merger is at work. So I'm thinking to Erosita, LST, Athena, Lynx, CAS, something that could somehow take a picture of what's happening before the merger. Actually, there are a plethora of simulation of what that should be possible to do in the pre-merger is not only a matter of localization, it's also a matter of sensitivity. Of course, we should understand how this gas flow behaves in order to make simulation. Here we did something on different hypotheses of what will be the luminosity at merger, but it's speculative, I would say, using 110 or Eddington or L Eddington, and including some absorption, because we know there's absorption. In the pre-merger, I don't know. The pre-mergers will be quite hard for the localization. However, how could be prepared now for the observation that will start? I think that for the observational programs we have now, with the mission we have now, I'm thinking to Chandra, XMM, or even, ground-based instrument, we should take some risk to observe good candidates because we should know how to catch this system when we will happen. This will help us to verify the goodness of our selection, will allow us to make a feasibility with future mission we will have. And of course, we also would try to improve our theoretical understanding of the red noise, of how the circumbinary disk will work, and try, for the observational point of view, to calibrate the false the false positive among candidates. I will skip this one and we leave here with a final slide. I would not go with all this item here. However, in the next decade, we will have a plethora of electromagnetic missions that will help us to understand the physics of this system. And together with the gravitational wave of the mission, could try to make clear the panorama of the in several aspects of the black hole. Let me stress that having one of these two messengers will provide us with the half information, so it will be fundamental to have both of them working in synergy for the next decade. And I will thank you.
Takes time. Okay, questions? Yeah, over there.
Thanks, Alessandra. I was wondering whether, because you presented us a number of fractions depending on of AGN that should be merging depending on the distance and the separation, and but you say I don't think you say anything about predictions about these ratios. I mean, simulations must give us some number to compare with, no? So for example, in the case of the large separation, you say the if I made the math correctly, it was something of the order of 10 to the minus 4 diffraction, because it was 0.99 times 0.98, so 2 times 10 to the minus 4. Is that consistent with expectation? And how about the smaller separations? That is actually even lower, I guess, as ratio.
So for the largest separation, we have some prevision on the sample. I mean, as I show you, the different sample you select could provide you with different answer, of course. However, in the rate of AGN, I show you, well, maybe it's too late. However, we have a good agreement with numerical simulation in the sense that if you compare, for example, in the study of dual AGN as be made in the X-ray and optical, the fraction of dual AGN is consistent with the hydrodynamical simulation with the mass fraction of one. So in the case in which there's a merger of two equal massive black holes. For the closer separation, of course, this is much harder to say, because in this case, you should put inside your simulation a lot of physics that you actually don't know very well, in the sense that we don't know how this final stage of evolution, behaves. So it's harder. And however, there are from the theoretical point of view, there's a very huge effort from simulation and theorists, I would say, start to understand how from the fraction of dual AGN we measure a separation of kiloparsec, we could have an estimate of the fraction of coalescence we will observe. And it's an important point, of course, but it's a lot of ingredients inside that we don't know very well. This is why my last sentence, we should try to take some risk now to observe system just to understand maybe this is not a real binary AGN, but if it is a binary AGN, then we learn a lot about the gas, the dynamics, and this will help to evaluate the binary that we would like to observe with Lisa, Tina, and whatever in the future. So for the closer separation, it's much harder, yeah.
Okay. Other questions? Okay.
Hi, I was wondering whether with Lisa, all this system will be detectable with LISA, like months, you said, before the merger.
Depending of the mass.
Yeah, and I was wondering whether, I get that there will be like a sort of general noise with LISA due to the contribution of the supermassive black hole merging in the universe. So I was wondering whether with this you can try to estimate like a luminosity, the analog of a luminosity function for merging supermassive black holes in the universe.
So the problem of a gravitational wave background will be due to the frequencies in which LISA and PTR works. It will be much more, I mean, much more hard for the PTR. For LISA, we do not have that much this kind of problem. The main problem is that depending on the mass, the localization of the smaller black hole masses for LISA is better with respect to the larger mass, but from the electromagnetic counterpart, we will be more sensitive to larger masses. So it would be not easy at all.
Okay. One short final question.
I was just wondering if there are simulations that predict that the two black holes will get rid of all the gas, and so we will see nothing at all in the when they are very close together.
Sorry, the double black hole?
In which the binaries will get rid of the gas in the center, and so in the end we're unlucky and we are not expected to see them. In the electromagnetic, at least.
I don't know if there are. Yes, in the, there are simulation, mainly cosmological simulation, including several amount of gas, probably also the one that you are mentioning. However, from observation of sample optically selected in X-ray, we found several sources. I would say also half of the fraction, although the sample is small, in which the source appear compton-thick. Then we, for example, in X-ray, we do not expect to see anything. And yeah, it's a problem. It could be.
Okay, let's thank Alessandra again. And the next speaker is Filippo Mannucci, who will talk about uncovering the missing population of dual AGNs with Gaia. And while Filippo sets up this presentation, I would like to remind you that we need to wear the badge. If you are not wearing the badge, please wear it, because it is requested by the organization here. And, okay.
Okay, hello everyone. Thanks for organizing this meeting. And I'd like to present a novel technique to detect the dual AGNs. So the first part of the story that Alessandra explained us. So when the AGNs are distance more than 1 kiloparsec, basically. So the work that I'll present is already on AstroPH. You can on the archive you can have a look there. These are the co-authors and with an additional number of contributing researchers. So everything starts, as Alessandro explained, from galaxy merging. You know that the cosmology think that the galaxy grow hierarchically by adding up many smaller systems. And in this simulation, you see that there are black holes wandering around. So each subgalaxy takes into the system a supermassive black hole, a massive black hole in this case, that they stay there for a long time, like 1 giga year. So we want to detect these systems. So the models, there are many models about this this system, and they make a number of predictions. For example, the distribution of separation, the number of AGNs that you expected to see as a number, as a function of separation, and this depends a lot on the physics of the merging or the re-sparring, or for example, the number of AGNs, of double AGNs as a function, as a fraction of single AGNs. You see that in this model, this number increases with redshift rapidly, and it's about 1% at redshift 2, or something like this. So, why is it important to look for these dual AGNs? First of all, to see if they really exist. This is a basic prediction of the models, so we want to test if they really exist. Then we can test the models, computing the distribution of separation, mass ratios, luminosity, redshift evolution. Of course, it is important because this is the parent population of the merging black hole that will be detected by LISA in a few years. So what is the current observational status? In the local universe there are several objects known. For example, this is the case of NGC 6240 in the X-ray with Chandra. But at high redshift, the situation is much more sparse. This is a very recent compilation showing the projected separation of the dual AGNs known as a function of redshift. So this is 10 kiloparsec. These two lines are 1 and 2 arcseconds, projected distance, separation. And you see that at redshift about 0.5, there are many, many systems at several tens of kiloparsecs. So basically systems in different galaxies before merging, basically. While systems in the same galaxy, so below, let's say, 8 kiloparsec, are very few. There are exactly 4 systems known at redshift above 1 and separation below 8 kiloparsecs. So this part, which is the most interesting, is actually empty. So if you look for dual AGNs, you will also find lens AGNs. You know that these lens AGNs are very interesting systems for a number of topics, in particular because they can sample the substructure of the dark matter halo in the lensing galaxy, and so you can also study the nature of the dark matter. So in this case also you have two AGNs with small separations, and so you will also find with all the technique looking for dual AGNs. So if you to detect dual AGNs, you need high resolution because they are close, and also wide sky coverage, because these are rare systems. Okay, so Gaia in this case is a very important instrument because it is an all the sky survey, and the resolution is 0.1 arcsecond more or less. So this is in principle a perfect instrument to detect dual AGNs. Let me remind you how Gaia works. It's a spinning instrument, so it's always scanning the sky. So the objects are always entering the detector, and when a bright object enters into the detector, the onboard software detects it and applies a photometric window, so close, photometric window which has a shape of 0.7 times 2 arcseconds. And for faint objects, as we are interested below G of 16, the image is not saved. It's only saved a light curve so the light is projected into the across scan direction, and all the light profile is saved. And this is done in many directions. So each object is observed many, many times in different scanning directions. What happens if you have two close by objects? If the objects have a distance between, let's say, above 0.7 or so arcseconds, the software applies two different windows, so you will have two different entries in the catalog. These two objects are completely separated, so no problem, you completely resolve and separate these two objects. What happens if you have two objects which are closer, 0.2 or 0.3 arcseconds? In this case, usually only one photometric window is used, so you will have only one entry in the catalog. These two objects are not separated, okay? But you can understand that this is not a single object, but it's a double object, by looking at the light profile of the objects. In this case, you can find a single object with two peaks. the situation is not as easy, of course, because sometimes if you use a different scanning selection, maybe in this case only one window is used, so these two objects are can be recognized as a single object with a double peak, and of course in this case for the different scanning direction with these two objects only produce one peak. So at the end we decide to use a statistical approach. So we define this Gaia multi-peak technique, looking for the objects in which the fraction of the scan showing multiple peaks in single or double or separated objects are above a given threshold. And we computed that 8-10% of the scan, when objects shows a double peak in more than 8 or 10% of the scan, this is a strong indication that it is has a double nature. Of course, this is a serious problem because the resolution of Gaia, which is intrinsically 0.1, is degraded to 0.7, something like this. So to recover the Gaia resolution, you need to go and look at the multiple peaks. So we have applied this technique to the known AGN with spectroscopy, and we discovered several hundreds of candidates, about 220, which is about 0.1% of the known AGNs. Of course, this technique has some limitation. First, it is an optical search, so we miss all the heavy obscured AGNs, of course, and also the luminosity ratio between the two cannot be very large. It can be up to 3 or 4 magnitudes, no more. So, what is the actual sensitivity of this method? We can compute this starting from HST images, really. In this case, you see that the red line is the pairs, the known pairs in the HST image, which have not recovered. And you see that we don't recover anything below 0.15 arc seconds. The green line are the objects that are recovered as unseparated objects, and the blue one as separated objects. You see that between 0.15 and, say, 0.7, we can recover we can really exploit the resolution of Gaia survey. So basically we are covering this region here, between 0.15, which is 1 kiloparsec mainly, and 0.7 arc seconds. This is the sensitivity of our technique. But does it work? Well, it works. There are 26 AGNs selected by this GMP technique that are in the HST archive, and all of them show multiple images, multiple components. Of course, this is a biased sample because these AGNs are in the archive only because they were selected in some other ways, with variability or because they are correspond to different entries in the Gaia archive. So we also obtain images of a small but unbiased sample. These are images obtained at LBT of 5 systems, and you see that all of them have separation, have multiple components with separation between 0.3 and 0.6 arc second, exactly as expected. And more observations are ongoing. So what is the nature of these systems? There are three possibilities. Well, there are two possibilities. One is that a chance coincidence between an AGN and a foreground star, or this could be two AGNs. If there are two AGNs, can be either a dual or a lens system. There are several tests that we can do. Basically, the chance alignment with a star is a possibility, but it's limited to maybe 30% of the system. So we expect that 70% of the system are actually in AGN system. We also have spectroscopy for a few of them. This is a system observed by HSTs. You see, these are two AGNs, very similar, but you see that carbon-3 is only detecting the fainter object. So this is a dual AGN. This is not the same AGN, it's a dual AGN. We also have spectroscopy with Keck, IFU spectroscopy of three systems, GMP detected, and you see that one is a dual AGN, one is possibly a lens AGN, and one is possible an AGN star system. So maybe, basically, we are starting to populate this diagram. So we have two confirmed dual AGN selected by GMP that fall where they are expected to fall. And we will observe, we hope, 100 of this system to really populate this and starting to test the models with VLT mus, with VLT aries in the GTO time, and with KEK. And this is my summary. Thanks.
Thank you, Filippo. Time for a few questions. Okay. Fabrizio? Yes, of course.
I guess Chandra should be able to do some sub-pixeling separation for these objects. So 0.5 arc second, I think, should be clearly detectable.
Yes, we together with Emanuele, we have made a Chandra proposal on this. The problem is that this technique only works until now at high redshift, where you don't have a bright host galaxy that can confuse the system with star-forming regions or something like this. So Chandra has the resolution, but only has the sensitivity on a few special targets with high luminosity.
Any other question? Okay.
Thank you.
No, thank you again, Filippo. And the next speaker is Cristina Nanci, who will talk about the parsec scale view of candidate neutrino emitter blazars.
Okay, good morning everyone. I'm Cristina Nanci, and today I'll talk about the parsec scale observations of some candidate neutrino emitter blazars. This is a work that I'm doing in collaboration with the people listed here. And let me start by introducing what neutrinos and blazars are and why they are connected. So, first, neutrinos, these are particles with very little mass and they are neutral, and then they interact very weakly with the matter. So it's very difficult to detect them, and we need huge and very performing instruments as the Ice Cube Observatory at the South Pole to detect them. However, this is not enough, because even if Ice Cube have this is very performing, is able to detect these particles within very large areas. So it's very difficult to study the origin of these particles. However, we have an additional information from the physics of neutrinos that tell us that, in particular, high-energy neutrinos are only produced by the interaction of very energetic cosmic ray protons with the matter and the photon fields. So the sites in which we can find these energetic cosmic ray protons are blazars. These are radio-loud AGN with the jet pointing in our direction. and their powerful jets are able to accelerate cosmic rays up to the energies required for the production of high energy neutrinos. So now we understood the connection between neutrinos and blazars, and the advantage of this connection is that we can study it by studying the radiation coming from blazars. And in this context, the most important result was arrived in 2017, when a high-energy neutrino was detected in the proximity of a gamma-ray blazar TXSO506 that was found in a flaring state around the neutrino arrival by a multi-wavelength follow-up campaign started after the neutrino detection. So this is the first association between a neutrino and an astrophysical source. We have also a very important result on this association from the VLBI point of view. VLBI stands for Very Long Baseline Interferometry, and is a technique that allow us to have high angular resolution that allow us to observe within the parsec scale regions of blazars. This is very important because these are the sites in which the particle acceleration is thought to happen. So here I reported some results, the one from Rose and colleagues, that found a signature of layers in the jet of TXSO506 after the neutrino detection. And this is important because previous theoretical studies have predicted that this kind of signatures should be places of efficient particle acceleration. Also, from archival VLBI data, Lee and colleagues measured some parameters of the jet kinematics, and among various results, they found that the magnetic energy density decreased after the neutrino detection. And they interpreted these results as a possible conversion of the magnetic energy density into particle energy density. Also from population studies, we know from the works from Plavin et al. In 2020 and 2021 that it exists a correlation between the position of a sample of VLBI sources with with a sample of neutrinos. Also, they found a correlation between flares from this sample of VLBI sources with the neutrino arrival times. You can see from this plot, from this plot from Plavin et al. 2020 that the mean flux density of the sample of the blazars is higher than average around the neutrino arrival. So all these results together suggest us that the processes involved in the neutrino production can also affect the radio properties in the parsec scale region of blazars. However, we have only one association, test for this hypothesis. So we started in 2019 to collect new VLBI follow-ups of neutrino events. And we characterized the radio sources co-special with these events, and we searched for the enhanced radioactivity and the recurring radio properties possibly linked to the neutrino production, as done in TXSO506. And in doing so, we collected four new VLBI follow-ups of neutrino events for a total of 10 candidate counterparts. And among these, we selected five best candidates. So we due to the poor knowledge about the possible association between neutrinos and astrophysical sources, we had to select these best candidates on the basis of what we know about TXS-0506. So we selected the sources, blazar-like sources with the gamma ray association, and also we based our selection on the interest of the multi-wavelength community about on these candidates. So you can find here I reported some properties of the neutrino events. You can see the very large error region of these events, and in blue you can find the gamma ray sources, and in red the radio sources. You can all the analysis of these on these sources are presented in the paper that we just published, but the most important results came from the comparison of our data with archival VLBI data. However, if we don't have archival data, we can't do this analysis. So. For the this was the case of the first source that we observed, for which we provided the first VLBI observation. For the second and the third event, we found hints of enhanced activity at the neutrino arrival. You can see from this plot the flux density level of the second source that we observed. Seems to be higher with respect to the past. And this is the third source for which you can see the same plot as before. And for this source, we have another confirmation of the high state at the neutrino arrival by the monitoring of the Telamon program of this source that shows that this source seems to decrease its flux density more than 1 year after the neutrino detection. The Telamon program is a monitoring program for candidate neutrino emitter blazars. We also modeled our data with Gaussian components. Our new data and archival VLBI data in order to measure the parameters of the kinematics of these jets. However, we need more epochs to perform this analysis. So this is the initial phase of this kind of analysis. However, we collected all these VLBI follow-ups, but now we are collecting new follow-ups. For example, I reported some very interesting events. The one in December 2021 was found close to a source that was in a flaring state at several wavelengths. Also, these events in February 2022 is very interesting because it was found near this very peculiar radio source that is a candidate lensed object with a very rare milliarcsecond lensing features. And this is the first blazar with a counterjet. So it could be very interesting to connect it with a neutrino event. Also, we have two other follow-ups ongoing. One is possibly associated with a source that was identified by Plavin et al. In 2020 as one of the four most probable neutrino emitters. And the other one, the last that we are following, is possibly associated with two sources. One of them is in a flaring, was in a flaring state at the neutrino arrival, and the other one was previously associated with another event in 2018. So I leave you with my summary and thanks for your attention.
Okay, thank you. And time for questions. I have one very naive question because I'm not an expert. So we have this very convincing coincidence between the neutrino in 2017 and that blazar. How many neutrinos in general are detected by IceCube? What is the rate of
How many?
In general, I mean.
Astrophysical neutrinos, tens of events per year.
Per year, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Just to understand whether the association could be spurious. Probably not, because there is also the flare.
Yes. They calculated the probability of the coincidence, of course.
Okay, thank you. Anyway, tens of neutrinos per year. Okay. Other questions? Okay, if not, let's thank the speaker again. And next speaker is Paolo Padovani. Might only extremely rare blazars be IceCube neutrino sources? And yes.
First of all, good morning, everybody. Fantastic to be back. I'm one of the few people, I think three people in the room, who attended AGN1 in 1994. If there are others, I think one, myself, Andrea Comastri, and Marco Mignoli. If there are others, raise your hand. Okay, Giorgio Matt, four. Okay. So I know most of you, let's say half of it. I'm going to talk, I start now so I don't lose my time. I'm going to talk about neutrinos, IceCube, and blazars. So this is, since this is an AGN conference, I'll start by first telling you what neutrinos are in one slide, then move to IceCube, and then move to the core of my talk. And by now, I'm not using reader. Ma sembra che... Ma che succede? Sembra che sia...
Posso? Però è saltato questo.
So, sorry, we have technical problems. It switched.
Eccolo, dai, ecco.
Però è verde.
Ma quello è il cavo, eh? Quello è il cavo che si parla dei colori.
We are almost there. At least you see something, but we lost the color in the RGB.
Prova,
sì.
Ma in genere è la connessione lì.
Grazie.
Oops.
Non è che sia qua il problema. Che se...
Se dall'altra parte.
No?
Questo cavo va e va qui sotto. Temo che sia il cavo.
In genere la connessione tra il cavo e il computer che fa casino.
Dopo qui si vede bene.
Ah,
qui
ah.
Sembra
l'attacco
al motore,
ah. Perché si vede bene. Ah, sì, ho capito, è vero, sì. Vabbè. Oh, ok.
Ok. Ok. Sorry about the inconvenience.
Ok, so I gave my introduction already. So, let's start with neutrinos. What are neutrinos? The first and most important thing to remember about neutrinos is that they are Italian. Neutrino is an Italian word which means little neutral one. It was invented by Eduardo Amaldi and then was publicized by Enrico Fermi. They are tiny. The latest upper limit from the Catherine collaboration is that their mass, a maximum, is a million times smaller than the mass of the electron, which is really, really small already. They're neutral, they're weakly interacting, and they come in three flavors, the electron, the muon, and the tau neutrino. And they also can change flavor while they are in flight towards us, just to complicate our life. The second important thing about neutrinos, they are absolutely everywhere. Every cubic centimeter of the universe contains about 340 cosmic neutrinos. They come from the Big Bang, when everything was in equilibrium with everything else, including neutrinos. And then while you're sitting there, you're crossed by about 10 to the 14 neutrinos per second coming from the sun. So they probably are the second most common particle in the universe, apart from dark matter, but we don't know what dark matter is, so let's say they're the second most common particle in the universe. Ice cube. Ice cube is the largest neutrino detector in the world. It's at the South Pole. You don't see it here because it's actually underneath, down in the ice, almost to 3,000 meters. What Ice Cube does, it doesn't see neutrinos. It sees the effects of neutrinos impinging on the proton in the ice, producing particles which then decay, produce blue chunk of light, which is seen by detectors of Ice Cube. And based on the way they flare up, we can get the direction and the energy of the neutrinos. Ice Cube made the cover of Science in 2013 when they actually published a paper saying, look, we found a bunch of astrophysical neutrinos above 30 tera electron volt, that's 10 to the 12 electron volts, coming from somewhere in space. Why is this important? Because until then, we knew two neutrino sources in the universe. The first one was the sun. The neutrinos are produced by the usual reaction we all know and love. Four protons becomes an atom of helium. They produce a positron and a neutrino. And the energy there is about up to 1 MeV. The second source was supernova 87A, which exploded in 1987. In this case, it's called, the process is reverse beta decay. Protons and electrons get squashed to death. They produce a neutron and a neutrino. And in this case, the energy is about up to 10 mega electron volt. The neutrinos from Ice Cube, and just to answer Rizzoliti's question now, we detected about 150 to 200 neutrinos in the years that they started, above 60 tera electron volt, reaching 6 peta electron volt. That's a billion times higher than the energy of the neutrinos in the sun. Why? Because the physics is completely different. So now, do we know 152 neutrino sources? No, we don't, because as was said in the previous talk, the error circles of the positions of the neutrinos is actually quite large, typically 1-2 degrees, but it can reach 10-15 degrees. But as you can see from this projection, which is galactic, the dots are all over the place. So they're not coming from the galaxy, otherwise they would be on a disk there. They're coming mostly from other galaxies. So that's hint number one. And number two, as again was mentioned before, the only way you can get a peta electron volt neutrino is by having high energy protons smashing against protons or photons. They produce pions, which decay and produce neutrinos. The same reaction produces pi zeros, which decay and produce gamma ray photons. The energy and the flux of the two components is the same within a factor of two. So this is a very important result. Every neutrino source has to be also a gamma ray source intrinsically, meaning that if there is absorption, the source could be absorbed, as you don't see the gamma rays. The opposite is not true. You can have gamma ray sources produced by other methods when there are no neutrinos. So, in 2017, IceCube made another cover of science when they announced we have the first association between a cosmic neutrino and a blazar, a redshift 0.3365. The p-value is between 3 to 3.5 sigma, which is a pain, because physicists require 5 sigma for a discovery. So for them, this is a strong hint. This is the spectrum of the source, which was taken by Simona Paiano and her group. And as you can see, there are three very, very weak lines with equivalent widths up to 0.2 angstrom. This is the definition of BLAC. BLACs are very, very weak emission lines. So what happens is then? The literature is very confusing, so I'm going to give you a summary in two slides. First, the results from IceCube. IceCube got another bunch of 3 sigma results, unfortunately, always around that. So one from NGC68, 2.9 sigma, and one from three blazars and NGC68 again, 3.3 sigma, and another time-dependent excess from two blazars, NGC68 and MET7, which is almost a blazar because the angle is almost pointed towards us. And then there are results from other groups, including our own group. With Paolo Giommi, we got a 3.2 sigma correlation between a bunch of ice cube events and 47 gamma ray blazars. But they are blazars of a particular type. Their synchrotron peak frequency is above 10 to the 14 hertz. This is a typical ECD of blazars. We know that this low energy part is due to synchrotron emission, and these sources are defined by having the frequency of the synchrotron peak above 10 to the 14 hertz. They constitute a maximum 10% of all blazars. And then there are other results which were mentioned before in the radio, 2.9 sigma, 3 sigma, another association, 2.6 sigma. So we're always around there. So the take-home message is that we have a bunch of new additional 3 sigma association, but we still don't have the smoking gun or the 5 sigma. Blazars are all over the place. There are hints that only rare blazar subclasses are involved. And this is consistent with the result that our group got, and IceCube got as well, that blazars can explain maximum about a quarter of the IceCube signal. So there has to be another component. The first question, as you can imagine, there are about 5,000 blazars in the universe. When this guy was detected, the main question was, why this source? And with the paper that we published about 3 years ago, we make a suggestion which might help to explain this. We show that despite appearances, this source is not what it looks like. It's not a BLAC. What do I mean? I remind you that there are two types of blazars. There are the flat spectrum quasars, which have very strong and broad lines. They are quasars, of course. And then there are the BLACs, where the lines are very weak or if they're present at all. With Paolo Giommi a few years ago, we realized that there were two types of BLACs. The real BLACs, where the lines actually are not there. So the equivalent width is small because the line flux is small. They sit in low excitation galaxies, and so they are radiatorily inefficient accretors. This is a famous picture from Heckman and Best. On the left, you see the classical picture of standard AGN, type 1, type 2, QSO, QSO2. On the right, you see what happens when you go to low accretion rate. So let's say below 1% Eddington. Everything changes, and the borderline region disappears. And then there are the masquerading BLACs. The lines are actually there, they're strong, but in this case, the denominator, the continuum is very high. So the equivalent width is small because the continuum is high, and the lines are swamped by a very strong jet. And we showed convincingly that Texas 0506 is a masquerading BLAC. Why is it important? Theorists love this because you have more targets for your protons. If you have only the jet, you have protons and the jets and the photons from the jet. If you have a disk, you have additional targets, and you can produce more neutrinos. So we have this sample with Paolo Giommi of 47 blazars. We wanted to study them, but then we realized that they didn't have spectra, they didn't have redshift. Without redshift, you can do physics. So we embarked on a project which is called the Spectra of Ice Cube Neutrinos Projects, or SIN, and Simona will expand on that, where we want to characterize and redshift all the sources. And we're using three optical telescopes, ESO VLT, the GTC, and the LBT. And I work at ESO, I work also on high energy astrophysics, so it's nice that I can use it now. ESO facilities to do high energy astrophysics. And so one result of this project is that here I'm plotting gamma ray power versus radio power. The masquerading Big Lux are the one with big circles. As you can see, they tend to be very powerful because they need to swamp the lines. And we find that about at least a quarter of the geometry sample are actually masquerading Big Lux. So they are fake Big Lux. But there is more. PAX 1424 plus 240, which was one of the ice cube lists, we published a paper this year, and we showed that this is a masquerading Big Lux. And then GP6 1542, again, another member of the ice cube list, guess what? Is a masquerading Big Lux. And then PAX 0537 plus 178, you got the idea now, which is associated possibly with the neutrino, guess what? Is a masquerading Big Lux. I think there's something going on there. I'm trying to talk to some colleague who does statistics, and yeah, maybe we can do something there, right? But there is more. Apart from being masquerading Big Lux, they have other properties. First of all, they are all, as I said earlier, the synchrotron peak is about 10 to 14 hertz. So that's only 10% of all blazars. And this is a plot of the ICDs. Second, they are all very powerful radio and gamma resources, especially for their new peak. I'm putting here the frequency of the synchrotron peak versus gamma ray power. You see the in color, this masquerading Big Lux, they are all at the edge of the distribution. For their new peak, they are very strong gamma ray sources. And also, by being masquerading, they have a disk like flash spectrum quasars, but their jet is nothing like flash spectrum quasars. It's a Big Lux jet, which means low temperature brightness, low superluminal motion, low Doppler factor, and low Lorentz factor, which is a very rare combination. And some of them might even have FR1-like morphology. So how rare are they? I did a very simple calculation. Since, as you can see from here, Texas 0506, the famous source, is the one which has the lowest radio gamma ray powers. I'm almost done. I calculated how many sources with synchrotron peak about 10 to 14 hertz have radio and gamma ray powers larger than those of Texas 0506. And the answer is 1% of all gamma ray blazars. 20 blazars, 20 sources in the Fermilab, which is a very small number. So, what have you learned in these 12 minutes? That we are witnessing the birth of extragalactic neutrino astronomy. After two sources, now we have more. We still don't know what they are, but there are a bunch of three sigma associations, large with blazars. We are testing the scenario using optical telescopes, and Simona will expand on this. And it appears that only a very rare blazar subclass is involved, having these properties. What does it mean? I have no time to tell you. Ask me. Thank you very much.
Okay, time for a few questions, please.
Thank you, Paolo. I don't know whether you hear me through the mask.
Yes.
Thank you for this amazing talk. It's really, it was amusing, but also very informative. I just want to ask you a question. Can you comment on this detection of a neutrino event, which was related to this TDE event?
Oh, gosh.
The tidal disruption event. Can you comment? What's your opinion on that?
Okay.
If it is true, how can this fit in the whole scenario that you're proposing?
I was afraid somebody was going to ask me that. I don't believe it. We can talk about during the coffee. It's a long story. It's been over inflated, I think, this paper, unfortunately. But I don't believe the detection, the association.
Okay, next question.
Thank you, Paolo. I was also going to ask about this TDE, but let's go back to the jet. In fact, you talk about masquerading Big Lux in the sense that the disk is important, and it seems to be a key element. But back to 0506, the thing that made the statistic so significant is the flaring, and the flaring is clearly coming from the jet. So what's the key, the disk or the jet?
we think it's both. That's why they're rare. You have to have a disk, which is fast spectrum quasar-like, and a jet, which is VLAC-like. And the combination of the two, as you know very well, is quite rare. You need both. That's why fast spectrum quasars are not probably going to be neutrino emitters. They don't have the right jet. But we can, again, talk about this at the coffee break.
Sure. Thanks a lot.
Okay, final question, Fabrizio.
The question actually is not about the BLAC, but the rest of the neutrinos. Any clue of what is majority of neutrinos, astrophysical neutrinos?
Sure, plenty of ideas. Outflows, I know most of you are doing outflows. I published a paper a few years ago on neutrinos outflow, which was ignored by the outflows community. But outflows are pushing protons into the ISM. You have proton-proton interaction. You produce gamma rays, which have been detected now by stacking by Fermi, and you should produce low-level neutrino emitters. So outflows could be producing together a bunch of neutrinos, which individually might be hard to see by IceCube. Star-forming galaxies is another clear one. Maybe radio galaxies with a jet offline. I mean, there are plenty of possibilities. The problem is that IceCube is not sensitive enough to see them individually. So what I think is that the signal you see from IceCube is like an integrated background, and before you actually be able to detect individually the source, it's going to take a while, apart from blazar, which are, of course, very powerful.
Okay, thank you. Let's thank Paola again. So, following up on the same topic, the next speaker is Simona Paiano, who will talk about optical spectroscopy of blazar neutrino candidates.
Okay, to do a talk after Paolo is very hard, but let me try to do. And my talk will be about the optical spectroscopy of blazar neutrino candidate. The first slide are to introduce the topic, but most of the topic was talked about was talked by the previous talks, so I will be fast to do. Blazar are jet at AGN with the jet pointing towards the observer, but the thing important for my talk is that they are neutrino emitters, and indeed the only extragalactic astronomical object associated to an extragalactic neutrino event is a blazar. And the optical point of view of the blazar is that we can divide the class in two subclasses: the flat spectral radio quasars with strong emission lines, and the BLAC, where the emission lines are very faint or even absent. And for this reason, that 50% of BLAC has a unknown redshift or hardly answered. This sketch is to understand how the neutrino blazar connection is growing. This is not a historical sketch, but just to understand that we start from an anisotropic distribution of the extragalactic neutrino event that suggests us that the origin of these neutrinos is extragalactic. Then the association of the extragalactic neutrino with TXS 0506, the first unique sources with the association with neutrino events. And then, following the path, there is a growing sample of blazars that are accessible to the neutrino, up to arrived to the list of 47 gamma ray high peaked Bielak and intermediate peaked Bielak, matched with 30 neutrino event provided by Jommi et al. But the issue of this sketch is the several sources are missing of a firm classification, especially in the optica, and they have not a firm redshift. And without redshift, we cannot do physics for these kind of sources. Okay, sorry. Motivated by these issues, we start. My collaborator and me started the SIN project. SIN means spectral of ice cube neutrinos, candidate sources. And we start from a list of 50 neutrino candidates selected by Jommi et al. And from neutrino alerts. And the selection criteria of our sample is to be gamma ray sources, to be outside of the galactic plane, to have a synchrotron peak frequency greater than 10 to 14, so they are a high peaked Bielak or intermediate peaked Bielak, and they are associated, positional association, with ice cube neutrino events. And the aim of the project is to determine the nature, the real nature of the source, to derive the main optical spectral properties and the redshift. There are useful ingredients to model the multi-wavelength CED and to put constraint on the gamma ray and photon and the neutrino production. So we start a spectroscopy campaign for our blazar neutrino candidate sample using a telescope of the class of 8-10 meters. It's important to have to use a telescope with large aperture because it needs to have spectra of a very high signal to noise, spectra of a very high quality, to have the chance to detect the very faint emission lines or optical feature in the spectra. So we had spectra with the signal to noise greater than 15 up to 300. But for the case of TXS 0506, the signal to noise was more or less 1,200. And here, some examples of our spectra. And here, a summary about the main properties found in our spectra. The spectra are characterized by a power law mixture plus a signature of host galaxy in terms of the shape of the spectrum or detection of absorption line from the whole stellar population of the host galaxy that is an elliptical galaxy. Then we found emission lines, narrow emission lines, mainly narrow emission lines due to oxygen. In some cases, we found intervening absorption system due to magnesium and iron that allow us to put spectroscopic at the lower limit of the redshift. And in other cases, the spectrum was featureless. And now, the main result obtained with our campaign, all targets of our sample can be classified as Bielak except for two cases, there are quasars, because they show evident strong emission lines. For 33 target, we can provide a redshift. This is a range of the redshift with the average redshift of 0.4. That is more or less compatible with the redshift distribution of the BLAC. And for targets, we can set spectroscopic lower limits from intervening absorption lines. For 14 objects show narrow emission line due to oxygen 2 and oxygen 3, and for 6 cases we have both lines, and the luminosity of the line are compatible with the other BLAC. For 16 BLAC, there is a clear signature of the host galaxy, and we did the decomposition of the observed spectrum in the power law component due to the nuclear component by the nucleus, plus the spectrum of the elliptical galaxy, and here. 3 examples with different nucleus to host ratio, and where the nucleus to host ratio is lower, the signature of the host galaxy is more prominent, and also the shape of the spectrum reflects this. From the decomposition, we derived the absolute magnitude of the host galaxy. I remember that to study the host galaxy of the BLAC is not so easy, and the absolute magnitude range is range between -20 to -23.2. And from the absolute magnitude, we can derive the mass of the black hole. Okay, and for more or less 30% of our sample, that is, is not a numerous sample, we obtain a featureless spectra. But also, if we have not a feature in the spectra, we can derive a lower limit on the redshift, based on the minimum equivalent width method and the non-detection of the host galaxy feature. And the limits are very stringent, up to 0.87. Oops. So our results of our spectroscopy campaign provide us all ingredients to investigate the real nature of the blazar, the redshift, the luminosity of oxygen 2 and the luminosity of the oxygen 2 and oxygen 3, the continuous luminosity, and the mass of the black hole. And thanks to this information, we can try to recognize the masquerading BLAC in our sample using the diagram, for example, two diagrams reported in the last paper of Padovani et al. Of the SIM project. And we can see that in the diagram, radio power and oxygen 2 line luminosity, or in the gamma luminosity versus the radio power, you can see that the masquerade in BLAC are in the good, in the position of the AGN that is of the high excitation galaxy, AGN, that is the position of the flat spectral radio quasars. So So far, we found 9 plus 5 other BLAC that are not included in the JOMI sample, the original JOMI sample. We found this masquerading BLAC, but the analysis is ongoing. So we think that we can, there is the probability that we can discover new masquerading BLAC that are flat spectral radio quasar, they are masquerade of BLAC. And here the future and the next step of the STEAM project. Two papers are published, one dedicated to the spectroscopy and the second to the characterization of the source. And the STEAM3 paper will be dedicated again to the spectroscopy and the characterization on the whole sample study in our project. And the next step have to do other papers dedicated to the multi-wavelength and the multi-message CED to constrain the photon and the neutrino production and a theoretical interpretation of our data with the lepton hadronic model, just to provide a physical interpretation and to evaluate the connection between neutrinos and blazar. And that, oops, sorry, that, ah, okay. And that's all, and okay, these are the 3 flavors of neutrino from the particle zoom. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Simona. And questions? Yeah.
To the previous slide, not the conclusion, the other one. When you use the diagnostic, oh, yes, okay. This one. Sorry. Yes, I was wondering, when you put your measurement from these lines on this plot together with the gamma ray luminosity, would this be important to have simultaneous observation in order to recover the masquerade BLAC, or is not?
It's hard to have simultaneous observation for all sources of our sample. So, no, but I think that, okay, it's because it's hard. Some sources were okay. We used the gamma luminosity from Fermi, but no, because the sample is big, and some sources are completely not unknown, but almost, because only with our spectroscopy we can say that the source is a BLAC from the optical point of view, or a masquerading BLAC from all from the multi-wavelength data. But unfortunately, no.
Time for another question. Is there any? Okay, if not, let's thank the speaker again. And the next speaker is Gianluca Castignani, who will talk about confirming the powerful radio loud QSO 3C186 as a gravitational wave recalling black hole.
Come funziona? Hello, everyone. And today I will talk to you about recent work that we published recently on AI letters, where we strongly support the distant QSO, free QSO as a gravitational wave recoil black hole based on high resolution millimeter observations. So a brief bit of context. So we know that supermassive black holes may merge, and depending on the relative spin orientation and black hole mass ratio, the gravitational wave radiation may be anisotropic and give result to a kicked supermassive black hole that can be literally expelled out of the galaxy. Indeed, these kicked black holes may receive strong kicks with velocities as high as thousands of kilometers per second, as you can see here from the Blazer model that the PDF in velocity can be as a huge tail at high velocities. So these are indeed the most energetic events in the universe, where only a small fraction of the binding energy can be converted into a large energy budget in gravitational wave radiation. However, clear observational evidence of gravitational wave recoil are still missing. And this is an important question, as in fact, we don't even know if supermassive black holes really merge or they even eventually stall the final parsec. This is what we call a final parsec problem. So with this in mind, we studied this distant BCG of a distant cool core cluster that is a 3C source, and it's very peculiar as the host galaxy seems to be shifted in projection with respect to the position of the 3C quasars. And here is a nice deep image by our recent work by Morosita et al. This was also found originally by Chiaberge et al., which found this projection offset, as well as a puzzling offset between the BLR redshift that is associated with the QSO and black hole, and the narrow light region redshift that we believe is associated with the host galaxy itself. And this shift is huge, of 2,000 kilometers per second. So this raises as a strong candidate as a gravitational wave recoil. And now we wanted to test this hypothesis by high-resolution millimeter observations at 1 millimeter with NOEMA, targeting both CO and continuum. And thanks to that, we can, in principle, resolve the gas reservoir and QSO itself. And this is a strong test case, as in fact, previous candidate was in fact ruled out based on similar millimeter observations by work by De Carli et al. This study is also part of a larger campaign that I led with the goal of investigating the impact of the cluster environment in processing molecular gas in distant cluster galaxies. And here are one of the main results. So you can see in the background the HST image in the rest frame UV, and the contours show the NOEMA contours that you can see in green the gas reservoirs that seems it's clearly shifted with respect to the position of the quasars here. And the quasar itself in the background is actually co-spatial with the continuum emission in millimeter that we observe, while the Gauss galaxy reservoir is instead co-spatial with the galaxy, with the photo center of the galaxy itself. So we confirmed this offset in projection of 11 kiloparsec. Not only that, but we also confirmed the shift in velocity of 2,000 kilometers per second, as in fact the molecular gas reservoir is at velocity zero and is at the redshift of the narrow line region of the host galaxy, while at the position of the quasar, we don't see anything in CO, and we don't see anything in general at the redshift of the BLR, or minus 2,000 kilometers per second. And the large molecular gas reservoir is huge, is about 10 to 11 solar masses in H2 mass. So with these two confirmations, we confirm both the projection offset and the velocity offset, which strongly support the scenario that this is gravitational wave recoil. We have some alternatives, but they are, we believe, quite unlikely, and some are here. Like it can be an ongoing merger, but usually mergers are smaller velocity separations. It can be a three-body interaction of black holes, but still, I mean, where the lattice black hole is kicked and is associated with the QSO. But in this case, I mean, velocities are also quite smaller, or 100 kilometers per second. You can see here the PDF, and here is the peak, while CVC should be here, very, very far away. And also the QSO should be the lightest black hole, but it's still very massive, 3 to 10 to the 9 solar masses. So it can be also chance superposition where the QSO is hosted by a low mass galaxy, and based on the known CO detection at QSO, we actually can infer an upper limit to the stellar mass and of about 1 × 10^10 solar masses, and it's quite low for a very low AGN. And the last can be that we are at the bottom of the potential well, so we can, just because of this, we can explain the velocity shift, but still the velocity is huge, and while it is in principle possible, we should also explain with the same mechanism as the use spatial offset. So these are possible, but quite unlikely, and also disfavored by previous work that we did. And now I'm going to tell you more about this source, and I'm going to add pieces of evidence that support this scenario. So here is the intensity map, and you can see the molecular gas reservoirs, the morphology is quite complex, and spatial with the galaxy as a focal center, and the morphology is complex. In fact, there are two possible components that emerge as distinct components, the north-south component, that contribute to 10% of the total emission in CO, and in particular the south, it seems to be a trail that extends out down to the QSO position. And these appear not only morphologically as distinct, but also in velocity, as in fact they are shifted by about 100 kilometers per second. So, and this implies that we have overall a mild gradient between east to west direction, which suggests that we may see a mildly inclined disk-like structure. However, the morphology is quite complex and also the kinematic, so it's hard to tell conclusively. And also, here is the width map, and you can see that the width map doesn't show strong velocity gradient, but the peak is associated to position where it's close to the peak of the intensity map, which is quite in agreement with the disk-like structure, where we often see the larger width close to the center and a stronger concentration of the gas reservoirs. And we don't only see CO, but also continuum emission. It's continuum emission. The continuum emission is co-special with the QSO and strongly point-like, tight singulator noise, but there is also evidence of extended low singulator noise emission elongated along the low radio frequency jet direction. And in fact, by combining the low radio frequency observation and our millimeter observation, we can infer a Stieg spectral index of 1, typically of Stieg spectral synchrotron emission. Not only that, but we can also remove in the UV visibility map the point-like emission. What is left is almost nothing. It's a small residual at free sigma level and the elimination of this larger scale emission. And interestingly, we don't see any emission at the position of the CO emitting region. While we could have clearly detected the CO dust, dust continuum as the CO is shielded by dust and we could have detected it in the Rayleigh-Jeans regime. And we take advantage of this non-detection to infer, in fact, a dust mass of 2 × 10^8 solar masses based on Scoville relation. And we also use independent far infrared Heschel emission based on previous study to infer, based on the infrared upper limit, a dust mass of again 2 × 10^8. So excellent agreement between the continuum base and the infrared base dust masses. Now, with this dust mass upper limits and H2, we can have a lower limit to the H2 to dust mass of about 400, which is quite higher than what typically found for distant star forming galaxies. It's around 100. And similarly, the depletion time seems to be that is the ratio of H2 mass to star formation rate, or the inverse of the star formation efficiency. And the depletion time is exceed 1 GA, so it's still higher than main sequence value. So by combining the two, we can explain them as part of the H2 gas reservoir has been accreted by a past merger, but not effectively converted into star yet. And this is also in agreement with a whole merger that was suggested by previous studies on this same source, including our recent Morosito et al. Work. And alternatively, an explanation would be a non-galactic CO2 H2 conversion that will drop H2 and also the depletion time to very low levels. So now I wanted to give you with some future perspective and in particular the potential of Euclid and other future facilities to detect this type of sources. In particular, with Euclid, we expect thousands of distant clusters and BCGs in the next decade. And as you can see from this Blazer work, that the number of sources per unit area, it's peaking at redshift 1. So at this redshift, we have in fact the maximum number of below this redshift in general, it's cumulative. We expect the maximum number of sources of gravitational waves recoils. And that's all. And these targets are excellent targets for future SKA PTA based experiments, as in fact PTA will be sensitive to nanohertz frequencies that are sensitive to massive black holes, as we expect for radio loud AGNs. And this is challenging but feasible, and in fact prediction tells that with SKA1 in a few years of monitoring of pulsars we could have hope to detect single sources with a detection probability of 40%. These are prediction but they are promising. Yeah, and I stop here and I answer question. Yeah.
Questions? Yes.
Nice talk. I didn't understand the argument against the chance superposition, because the host galaxy of the quasar may be a gas poor elliptical, so you don't detect the CO423 because there's no gas in the host.
Sorry, what's gas full elliptical?
So you made the argument, an argument against the chance superposition of two objects.
Yes.
Along the line of sight. Right, based on the gas mass, if I understand correctly, that you don't detect associated with the CO, with the quasar.
Yeah.
Right? So I don't understand that, because the host galaxy of the quasar may be a gas poor elliptical in principle. So can you rule this out?
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, in fact, I just focus on our work where we in fact use the non-detection of CO to set an upper limit to the stellar mass, but we also have a companion work, for example, Orsita et al. Did this deep. We did this deep HST analysis of the field. And I can show here, and he did deep stellar population-based analysis of the system to, in fact, rule out the merger and also the presence of low mass galaxies associated with the core. So, I mean, it's quite a likely scenario. I mean, it's hard to have a smoking gun proof, but yes, it's. I mean, the host galaxy not to be detected should be very, very low mass based on different angle and not only CO, yeah.
Okay. Other questions? Okay.
So I have two related questions about the interpretation of the physical configuration. So the first one is this... Would you expect this one to be the more massive black hole to be recoiled? And the second one, where does the material accreted on the black hole comes from?
Okay, it's hard to tell if this is the most massive black hole. I mean, we don't have many observational evidence and gravitational wave candidates, so we are not at this stage yet. And what do you mean by the gas accreted? You mean the BLR or which type of gas?
So is this black hole accreting material that was previously on an accretion disk that has been recoiled together with the black hole, or is accreting material which is like for example the intercluster medium or something like that? So is there any interpretation about this?
Yeah, I mean the interpretation is that the BLR is bound to the black hole and is kicked out together with the black hole. Yeah, That's the possible interpretation that we give. Because the BLR redshift, we believe it's associated with the black hole itself, yeah.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again. So the final speaker of this session is Lumen Boko, who will talk about the growth of supermassive black hole heavy seeds.
You can put also the PDF presentation that is sent by mail. It's better at least. Okay. So, hello everybody. I am Lumen Boko, a postdoc at CIS in Trieste. Today I'm going to present you this work that I've done in collaboration with Andrea Lapi and Alex Sicilia, who is here at the conference. And so if you want to hear a follow-up of this work here, you can go and see also his poster if you are interested. So this is a theoretical work about, it's a kind of new mechanism, a new possible scenario for the formation of heavy seed for supermassive black hole, in particular in the early universe. And during the talk, I will try to give you, first of all, some motivation to put the work in a general context, and then I will show you the results, and finally, I will also propose a way to test this mechanism, to see if it's really happening or not inside the galaxies. So, let's start with the motivations. There are many motivations, but the main motivation is the high redshift quasar problem. What is the redshift quasar problem? Basically, as you all know, in recent years we have observed a lot of quasar at high redshift, up to 7.5, when the universe was extremely young, around 700 mega-year. And these quasars are believed to be powered by supermassive black holes of mass even bigger than 10 to the 9. And clearly this is creating somewhat attention, because if we believe to the standard Eddington limited gas accretion scenario to build up a supermassive black hole, basically we don't have enough time when the universe is so young to construct, to build these huge monsters when the universe had only 700 mega-year. So clearly we have a kind of problem, and in literature there are many solutions. And the solution can be divided in two main classes. The first class of solution is super Eddington accretion, in which basically you give up the assumption of being Eddington limited. You say basically that you can accrete gas at super Eddington rate, you put an Eddington factor of 3-4, and in this way you can build up a supermassive black hole in a very, very short time scale. The other possibility, the other class of solution, is instead through heavy seed of supermassive black hole. Basically, you start not from a stellar black hole, but you start from a black hole of intermediate mass. You can see here 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5 solar masses. And if you accrete gas onto this intermediate mass black hole, you can build up a supermassive black hole in a very short time scale, even if you are Eddington limited. So, now, this kind of solution only shifts the problem, because now the problem becomes how can we build up the seed in a very short time scale. And again, in literature there are solutions, there are mechanisms to build up the seed. I think the most famous one is direct collapse, in which basically you have a cloud of gas that for some reason doesn't undergo fragmentation and directly collapse to form an intermediate mass black hole. You have the possibility also to find these intermediate mass black hole inside globular clusters thanks to runaway stellar mergers. And finally, here comes my proposal, my mechanism, that is basically forming this heavy seed through gaseous dynamical friction in star-forming galaxies. Now, I want to give you now the general idea of this mechanism, but first I have to explain you a bit what is gaseous dynamical friction, just to recap a bit. So let's assume we have a gas distribution. All of these are gas particles that I've drawn. Let's assume we have an object that travels through this gas distribution. This object is usually called perturber, but in our case it will be, for example, a stellar mass black hole. So a black hole of stellar origin that travels in a gas distribution. So what happens when the black hole travels through the gas distribution is this. Let's say, thanks to the gravity of the black hole, the gas particles tend to distribute themselves in this way. They tend to create a kind of overdensity behind the black hole. a kind of wake of overdense gas. This overdense gas will interact gravitationally with the black hole, and in particular it will slow down the black hole. It will remove energy and angular momentum from the black hole. And this dynamical friction force has been studied in literature by many authors, both analytically and also numerically, and clearly depend on the gas density, on the mass of the black hole, on the velocity of the black hole. It depends on many things. But, okay, I don't want to enter into many details. This is just the equation for this force that remove energy from the black hole. Now, I give you the main idea of my process to form heavy supermassive black hole seeds. I don't have time to enter into details, so if you have still doubts at the end, you can ask me, or you can catch me at the coffee break, if there will be the coffee break, I don't know. But I hope to finish. So the idea is the following. Let's take a spherical gas distribution like this one. This could be, for example, the central region of a galaxy. In particular, I consider high redshift galaxies in this case, which are really star forming and very, very compact and dense in gas. So this is a gas distribution. There will be stars inside this gas distribution. And since there are stars, there will also be black holes of stellar origin. Now, these black holes will orbit around the center of the galaxy. But since there is gas, these black holes will undergo this dynamical friction force, they will lose energy, they will lose angular momentum, and the orbit will tend to spiral down toward the center, toward the very center, because these black holes lose angular momentum. So try to figure out the situation. We have many black holes. These black holes lose energy, and they tend to sink toward the center. When these black holes arrive to the center, they will start merging together, and so in the central region we will have a black hole that grows and grows thanks to the merge, to continuous repeated mergers with the stellar black hole that arrive to the center. So this is the general idea to grow the heavy seed. The heavy seed is grown thanks to these repeated mergers. Then once we have the heavy seed, gas accretion can become very efficient because the black hole is massive, and so gas accretion can bring the black hole to become supermassive. So this is the idea. As you can see, I didn't give you any number at all up to now, but clearly the time scale of this process is really important, because you can agree with me that this process is there, but if it takes 10 giga-years to bring this black hole to arrive to the center and merge with the central black hole, it's completely useless. Because as I told you, we want to solve the high redshift quasar problem. So we want to form a supermassive black hole very quickly. So the seed has to be formed even more quickly. And so we need at least a time scale for this process below 1 giga-year. So what to do to compute the time scale? I took a bunch of black holes with different characteristics, different mass, different initial condition, and I simulated them in different galactic environment. And what I found is a fitting formula for the dynamical friction time scale to compute the time scale for the sinking of this black hole toward the center. Now, I don't go into the details of all the details. Clearly, there are dependencies on many details of the black hole and on the environment. But what is important is the number in front that explicitates a bit the typical dynamical friction time scale for this process. And you can see that this number, the number that I find, is around 3 × 10⁸ years. So at least this number, the time scale for this process is below the giga year. So it is in the direction that we wanted in a certain sense. So once we have the time scale, we have almost everything, because with the time scale, we can compute the merging rate of this stellar black hole with the central black hole. As I told you, the central black hole grows thanks to merger, so we need to control the merging rate in order to control the grow rate of the central black hole. And the grow rate of the central black hole can be computed with this formula here. This is just the rate at which the central black hole grows its mass thanks to the repeated mergers. On the other hand, we still have gas accretion. We still have gas accretion on top of this mechanism. So if you put together the two equations and you integrate over time, what you get is the central black hole mass as a function of the galactic age. And this is the main result that I want to show, mostly the only result that I want to show you. And this plot basically shows the central black hole mass in logarithm, on the y-axis, as a function of the age of the galaxy, basically, again, in logarithm. Now, these two lines here are not from my process. These are simply gas accretion without my dynamical friction mechanism. And the dashed one is simply the Eddington limited dynamical friction. And the dotted one instead is super Eddington. And these lines are here just for reference, just to see how my mechanism perform. Now, so how does this dynamical friction emerging mechanism perform? This red line is the contribution to the central mass due to the merging of these stellar black holes that are arriving to the center. And you can see that this merging are giving an important contribution in the early phases of the life of the galaxy. Indeed, you can see that you can create a seed of mass 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5 in something like 30 mega years. So in a very short time scale, you create the seed. Now, if you add gas accretion on top of this heavy seed, you get this Chaya line. Sorry for the color. But this Chaya line is simply gas accretion on top of the seed that we are building thanks to the merging. And you can see that if you do this, at a certain point, gas accretion becomes very efficient and overcomes the merging process and is able to build up a supermassive black hole in a time scale that is much shorter than simple Eddington limited gas accretion. It is a bit less efficient than super Eddington, for example, but still it is able to alleviate the high redshift quasar problem. And this black line is simply the total mass that is the sum of the two contributions. So basically, what I show you is that we can still alleviate the high redshift quasar problem extracting the heavy seed thanks to these repeated mergers. So I show you, I thought of this process, I show you that it can work in principle, and the last slide is just a way possibly to test this process. Again, I told you we can form the heavy seed thanks to many mergers. All these mergers clearly will produce gravitational waves because they are black hole mergers, so we will have gravitational waves, and maybe we can detect this gravitational wave with future gravitational wave interferometers. In particular, I show here the plot of the detection rate of these gravitational waves as a function of redshift for future gravitational wave interferometers like Einstein Telescope, LISA and ECHIGO. And from the plot, you can clearly see that you can see gravitational waves coming from this process here. Maybe the most difficult task is to disentangle this kind of gravitational waves from the one that comes from other sources. But again, there is much more work than just what I'm presenting here. We have also found ways to try to disentangle the two kind of gravitational waves. So yes, I just wanted to tell you this, and I thank you for the attention, and see you at the coffee break.
Okay, questions, short ones, because we have the coffee break.
So basically you need many black holes for to merge in order to get to this heavy seed black hole.
Yeah, basically.
What kind of star formation you need to form those black holes? And it is a reasonable star formation for a redshift 20 galaxy or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, there are many things that I skip, and this is one of them. I'm considering IZ galaxies that have somewhat huge star formation. You know, there are all these recent observations by ALMA of these dusty star-forming galaxies that are strongly star-forming galaxies that have star formation that ranges from 50 solar masses per year up to even 1,000 solar masses per year. Clearly, I've done for all the star formation in reality. I show you just one case. That galaxy has a star formation of 100 solar masses per year, the one that I show you. But to produce the gravitational wave plot, you have to integrate over all the galaxies, right? So I took the luminosity function at redshift 6. And so the luminosity function can be translated in star formation. And so basically you do it for all the galaxies with all the star formation, weighting them with the statistics given by the luminosity function. So clearly, the more you have star formation, the bigger the seed will be, and so the faster the process will go. If the galaxy form one solar masses per year, you will form a smaller seed, clearly. But I expect that high redshift quasar are also formed in strongly star-forming galaxies. Maybe I'm wrong in this, but...
Okay, next question. Yeah.
Hi, thank you for the very nice talk. I was wondering Did you consider or can you comment on the kick that black hole, the product of the black hole merger gets in the central cluster?
That's a very nice question. I think the kick could be a very important thing. That let me say, this is clearly a semi-analytical computation. So in order to really have a realistic result, we should do a simulation. In principle, here I've done a semi-analytical computation. So I didn't keep into account the kick into the computation, but I tried to do some order of magnitude estimate. As you could see from the talk also of before, the average recoil kick that you get in merging of this black hole is around, if I'm not wrong, around 100 up to 300 kilometers per second. If I'm not wrong, I mean, you have tails that can arrive even 2,000, but the average is around there. I've made a kind of a small computation to ensure that this kick is not enough to kick out the black, to really kick, at least a kick of 100 up to 300 is not enough to kick out the black hole of the central region of the galaxy. And so at least in this respect, we are safe. Then what happens? Once you build up the central black hole more and more, so once you arrive to bigger masses, the mass ratio between the stellar origin black hole and the central black hole increase. And when the mass ratio increase, the kick velocity decrease. So this kick could be really a problem, but really at the beginning of the process. Then even if the initial black hole gets kicked out, but remains inside the central region, the dynamical friction becomes more effective because the black hole is more massive, and moreover, the kick tend to be radial, usually. I don't know if I'm saying correct things, but the kick tend to be radial, and the dynamical friction process is more efficient for radial orbits, for more radial orbits. So we expect that still, even the black hole that are kicked out, they could fall in still short time scales. I don't know if I answered correctly, but okay.
Okay, one final question with a short question, short answer.
Thanks. A very nice idea. You answered to my second question now, okay. So I have only one. That is, did you consider also the time need to segregate stellar black holes in order to be denser enough to undergo to this mechanism?
Did I consider the time? I mean, what I compute in the equation that I show you, I don't know if this can answer your question. What I compute in the equation that I showed you before is the time scale. I mean, I can compute the time scale for each black hole. I mean, depending on the mass, of the black hole, not only on the mass, also on its initial position and velocity, you have a different time scale, okay, of going down toward the center. So each black hole will have its own time scale of segregation. I don't know if it's if this is what you... Okay, we can talk at the coffee break.
So I apologize. We have to finish here. We have a few announcements and then the coffee break regularly. Sorry, Nick.
I know you need coffee, all of us. I have a few announcements. First, people that have given the talk in the next session, we are still missing a few presentations, so send us the PDF or the PPT, whatever you want, but send us eyes up. Second, flash talk presentations. We are scheduling all the presentations for tomorrow, which will be the first session, and we go through alphabetical order, so send us also eyes up those presentations to the official email. Third, for the coffee break, I also said it yesterday, I repeat it today, people that ask for special requirements, they have to notify the catering people upstairs, okay? They have to notify themselves. Last, social dinner. We are still missing a few payments, actually several. We need to notify the restaurant tomorrow. So if you could please pay cash at the registration desk by the end of today, it would be better. Thank you very much. And reconvene. Pardon? Is that 8? But I will give you more information tomorrow.
So we reconvene 10 minutes after the schedule. So a slightly shorter coffee break, but please be on time at 11:40. Thank you.
vedo dei PDF.